Hello again, I'm Mr. Tarrou. Today I'm going to start the very first set of notes for one of the other classes I teach, AP Statistics. AP Statistics is a study of data analysis. Think of computers and all the mountains of information that we store now, presidential elections, medical studies, anything that collects data. We have to analyze that somehow and get conclusions out of that data. That's what we attempt to do in statistics. The first step of, I don't know why I put a two up, the first step of data analysis is drawing a graph, looking to see what your picture, your distribution of data looks like. And the first two types of graphs we're going to look at is really going to be for something that we don't do a whole lot of math to in statistics, or at least in an intro to statistics, and that is the categorical variable, or we're going to look at the two categorical graphs. The first type is a pie chart. Those are the circles you see in the newspaper maybe or on the internet. We're all, you know, maybe not comfortable making them, but we've seen them a lot. Well, pie charts are good, but without the help of a computer, they're a little bit awkward to make by hand. We must contain all the categories of a whole within that pie chart, and we only use these when we want to emphasize each category's relation to a whole. So I got two sets of numbers here. I'm only going to work with one set. But if I want to compare my grades, and these are not my grades, but from, say, one period of statistics to the second period of statistics, that would not be really all that great to attempt to do with the use of a pie graph. So, but let's take the first row here and see what we have as far as letter grades. Now, these are all numbers, but we must not forget that we're looking at categorical graphs. So, we got a couple of people here with A's. We have a few people here with B's. We got three people with a C, and one person, let's say that they just, you know, haven't made up a test yet, with an F. Now, we do a 10-point grading scale, in case that looks a little bit weird for you. I want to represent this with a pie chart. Okay, well, first of all, you know, your grades, I don't have anyone with D's, but, you know, your grades are parts of a whole. You know, there's four or five grades we give, five grades. And, you know, I'm going to represent all of those possibilities. So we're going to have, you know, a certain section for A's, a certain section for B's. We got a section for C's. We're running out of colors here, D's. And then finally, F's. And we're going to represent that in a pie chart. Well, pie charts start with a circle. And within that circle, you're representing percents of data that are in that category, not counts. So just because there's two people that have an A, you can't show that in a pie chart. You must do that with percent. So this is 10 people total, and if two people have an A out of 10, 2 divided by 10 is 20%. So I'm going to try and guesstimate as close as I can, this is the awkward part, what 20% of a circle looks like. Well, that's not quite 25, so let's say it's right here. So this is my A's, and you would not write this in a pie chart, but that's 20% of the data. Now we have B's. There's four people that have a B. Well, 4 out of 10 is 40%, so that's a little bit less than half, so I'm not going to go half the circle, but a little bit less. And again, I'm trying to guesstimate these values, and that's again where the awkwardness comes in when you're doing this by hand. My B's represent 40% of my class, and again, I'm just doing this for teaching. We do not put these percents inside of a pie chart. We have C's are 3 out of 10, or 30%, or almost one-third of a circle. That was an orange here. So let's say that it's about, yeah. So I got some kids making C's. That represents 3 of my 10 students. And you can see why I picked 10 people. I can do my math easy. That's 30% of the data. There's no D's, and my F's are 10%. So I'm just trying to represent all my categories of the whole inside of one circle. All my categories of my whole must contain all the categories of a whole are represented in that circle. Now here's the disadvantage of a pie chart that it doesn't have very much flexibility. If for some reason, like let's say, you know, come on, we are talking AP stats, right? No one's going to make it 26% without something weird going on. Well, they missed a test and it's not been made up yet. So what if I wanted to not represent that value of an F and just use A, B, and C, just represent some of my categories of the whole? No way, can't do it. So pie chart cannot show this data if I want to leave out that F. So awkward to make is restrictive in the fact that you have to use all the categories of the whole. You can't even ignore one if you'd like to. And not great for side-by-side comparison, only if you want to represent each category in relation to the entire whole. And again, I got to fill that back up again because you can't have just part of a circle. You got to have it all. You got to have it all, man. So that means we want to look at bar graphs. So copy that down, and I'll write some new notes while you do. Okay, did you get all those notes down? Take a second, pause, and maybe copy these notes down if you like. Okay, so bar graphs. We're back. All right, bar graphs, the second type of categorical graph that we have, much more flexible, much more common, and we make these much more often in statistics. Here's some benefits. I'll have to add some more in a minute. They're easier to make and read. They can compare any set of quantities that are measured in the same unit of measure. In other words, all your categories don't have to come from the same one singular whole. We can make side-by-side bar graphs for easy comparison. We're going to do that in a second. And you don't have to use all the categories of a whole. Now, I'm going to, that means that like if I don't want to include this person that got an F just because they didn't make up a test, I don't have to. But I'm going to just for this purposes. When you set up a bar graph, your variable of interest is along the x-axis always. The vertical axis has two types of names, or you can put two types of variables there, sort of, how you count. It can be a frequency or simply a count, like I've got two people with an A. I've got four people with a B. Now, these are not just counts. These are sort of like 10, 20, 30, 40. That's not 2, 4, 3, and 1. No. You can do frequencies, which are a count, or you can do percents, which I'm out of better room to write. It's called relative frequency. That's what we call percents in AP statistics. So we're going to do a relative frequency bar graph. And we're going to display these two sets of data side by side. So, here's how you make a side, or one way of making a side by side bar graph. I can make a bar for one period bar graph and another bar graph for another period, but bar graphs are allowed to have spaces in between their categories, and because of that, if we're going to make a side by side bar graph, they're often just crammed in the same picture to make the comparisons even easier. So we got 20% with A's in period, let's say it's already in blue, so period 1. We got 20% with A's. We got 40% with B's. We've got 30% with C's. And that one kid that got the F because they haven't made up their test. Now let's do period 2. In green. Now you see I'm kind of making a key with my graph to let somebody else know how to read it. Well, in this class I've got 3 out of 10, or 30% with A, since I'm doing a relative frequency on the y-axis. I've got my B's, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, so the same 40%. I hope you can see these colors on the computer. I'll shade that in a second. We have two people in 70s. Now, if you're doing a 10-point grading scale like my school, that's 20%. So we have 20% with C's. And we have a 65, so there's one person with a D. So in case you can't see the colors here, we have the unfilled bars for period 1 and the filled in bars for period 2. Now, you can just really quickly glance at them and say that the B's are the same. Period 2 has more A's, fewer C's, so overall the trend is that the second period class is a little bit stronger in their grades right now, and there's still a couple people doing poorly in each one of them, but overall, second period has more A's at 30% compared to 20%. The B's are the same. Second period has less people, with C's at 20% as opposed to 30% for first period, and the D's and F's, I got one person with a D. The lowest grade in period 1 is an F. Now, I just compared and contrasted those two classes. That's also something we do a lot in statistics, is analyze what we see, and I just gave you numerical values in my conclusion to say that right now, second period is doing stronger. I didn't say they were doing better just because I said so. Okay, now, one thing I would like to talk about as well with this graph that we're looking at is we have to be careful when we look at data and we're trying to determine if it's quantitative. You'll see me write that word a little later. That means that my data is numbers and I'm going to work with it as raw numerical data, or categorical. I'm going to keep these grades up here and we're going to look at just period one. We'll look at this other row of numbers instead. And we're going to say, okay, well, these are all numbers. You know, when you get a grade, that's a number. Well, there's going to be two types of variables we study, quantitative and categorical. Right now I'm going over categorical variables. Well, we have numbers. Now see, I erased the A, B, C, D, and F. So it seems like the letters have gone, the categories have gone. Well, below here, I'm going to make something that later you might think looks like I'm setting up something called a histogram. But here I'm going to put that this is scores of 100 to 90. And here in this area, I'm going to put scores of 89 to 80. And then I've got scores here of 79 to 70. I've got 69 to 60. And then I've got below 60. Now, it seems like I'm going to make something later called a histogram. It seems like I've got my x-axis representing numerical values, but I've got it in groups of numbers. Are you in this group of 100 to 90? Are you in this group of 89 to 80? And then going down to just simply this last group, which I'm no longer counting by 10, which is really the big giveaway, of just 60 or below, or below 60, so 59 or lower. I mean, that's 60 values included in there. That's the F. So I'm using your numerical grade to put you still into a category, which kind of makes that little bit of a gray line there between making something called a histogram, which is for quantitative data, and a bar graph for categorical. So even though I'm going to drop the A, B, C's, and D's, I'm going to handle these numbers as still being categorical and putting you in a group based on that. So 190, well, that's three people out of, you know what, let's do a frequency on the y-axis instead of percent. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So I got three people in the 90s to 100. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 people in the 80s. I've got 79 and 71.
Kira Kalashian, your ride is in front of the building.
So I've got 79 and 71 again, my two groups in the 70s. I have one person 65, so one person in the 60s, and nobody below 60. I'm putting the gaps in between these categories to really emphasize again that I'm taking your numerical grade to put you in a group or a category. Later when we study something called histograms, where we're using the numbers in their raw state to not assign a category or a grade, then these are going to run together and all touch. But bar graphs also always have gaps between the bars or between the classes. So there's the two type of categorical graphs. Don't think that you can just get away without doing your homework. There's still going to be issues when you get into those problems and you try and set them up. They will be a little bit harder than you think, even though this all looks maybe rather familiar. Have a good day.